great. No, thank you all. And thanks, Nick. So, yeah, that is our acronym. And the reason we came up with that was because it gave us a rather lame acronym, but it also really captures what we're about. So we're interested in the role of evidence in influencing policy, but then we're also interested in what influences the evidence itself. So that's why those words come together in our acronym, because we're interested in sort of both ends of the spectrum there. And because we're at the Charles Perkins Center, we organize our work around what we call nodes, or collaborative groups of individuals from different areas. And so I'm going to tell you about three of our nodes, and it's going to be a very sort of high-level view of what we do. And then Nick's going to talk a little bit about one of his projects, and Quinn also, and then Barbara. So that'll give you a little more detail about three aspects of what we're doing. So it's a lot to cover, and if anybody wants to interrupt, you know, at any point, please do. So I'll start with a broad overview. We have one of our nodes is called Bias and Research Integrity, and this was the first node we started up about 3 years ago when I arrived here. And we do what's called research on research, or meta-research, and actually some journals now have even special sections on meta-research. And basically, we study bias in the design, the conduct, and the dissemination of research. And so we're interested in the entire research cycle and what might introduce bias in that research cycle. And we do this by doing quantitative studies that I'll give you an example of, and Nick will follow up with a little bit more, but also doing qualitative studies to really try to get at what's influencing research. And we haven't done this as much in the last few years, but in the past we've also, and we'd like to do more, we actually design interventions to try to increase the integrity of research and really test those. So for example, one thing we're starting up at the University of Sydney is a registry of animal studies, and we want to evaluate whether that registry will decrease publication bias, for example. And it's a registry that we then want to open up across Australia to other universities to participate. So that's something we'll actually be able to monitor and see what's happening. So this is how we think about bias in research. So there's all different points in the research cycle where you can introduce bias, and starting with the question that you're asking, the population that you're studying, the method that you're using. So a lot of research on bias has been focused on the method. So what are the biases in the methods? So I just want to point out here that we're really interested in the big picture, not just biases in the methods. We want to look at like how the research is actually conducted. So for example, we've done a lot of work looking at corporate documents, describing what happens behind the scenes. Even if something looks like it has a rigorous method, it might not be conducted in that way. And then looking at whether the research is published in its entirety or not. So that could mean whole studies not being published, but it could also mean certain outcomes from a study not being published to make things look more favorable. And so we're really interested in all parts of that and do research on all parts of that cycle. One thing we've been looking at in the area of nutrition that we've been doing a lot more since coming to the Charles Perkins Center, and Alicia Fabri has been involved in this project, is this idea of getting at the questions. That's really, really hard to get at, like what actually drives the questions that are being asked in research, but obviously that's a big place to introduce bias. And so one of the things we've been looking at is sponsorship and how that influences questions. So for example, we've done work looking at websites of large food companies and following up what kind of research they're funding and where that research is getting published. And we have found, for example, that Coca-Cola is much more likely to fund research on physical activity than sugar. So basically this is, our interpretation of this is that they're distracting from research that might put their product in a negative light and getting people to focus on something else in terms of the research agenda. And then we do a lot, I said methods are, you know, analyzed a lot, and we do a lot of work on methods, so working on tools to assess bias, you know, is the study really truly randomized, or is it, you know, like a iPod shuffle. We look at bias in animal studies. So a lot of quantitative work really trying to tease out the different aspects of the methods and what biases the result. And this is what I mean by biasing the result. This is, and Nick's going to talk about his work on this, but this is a classic type of meta analysis that we do. So this is published in the Cochrane Library, and this was a study that looked at individual studies that, so each line there is an individual study that looked at the association of pharmaceutical industry funding with an outcome that favored the sponsor, even when you're controlling for other design features. And then you put all those studies together quantitatively in a meta-analysis, and you get that diamond at the bottom. And what that tells you is, looking across all these studies, that the drug industry-sponsored ones have about a 30% larger effect estimate than the ones that aren't sponsored by the industry. So that's a way that we quantitatively look at bias. You can do these meta-analyses to try to see if a particular factor is associated with increasing your the size of your effect. Does that make sense to people?
So that diamond comes from a comparison of studies that were versus weren't funded by the industry?
Yeah, so that diamond is not a direct summary, but basically summarizes all of those studies above, and each of those studies compared the industry to the non-industry in their effect estimates. So this combines all those studies together. And we just actually, this is an update of a Cochrane review, so we keep updating this review, and it keeps growing. People keep doing these type of studies, this is the results of the studies being more favorable, but we also look at conclusions, which are more the interpretation. So one of the big areas, I think we're actually, I can honestly say, we're one of the few groups in the world who's had a real emphasis on studying the impact of conflicts of interest as an influence. So we're really interested in conflicts of interest. Quinn's going to talk more about some of our thinking on this today, but we're interested in how conflicts of interest of both individual researchers and institutional conflicts of interest influence research and policy and evidence synthesis and things like clinical practice guidelines and clinical decisions. So we're doing a lot of work around this, and again, it's looking at whether conflicts of interest are associated with affecting the outcomes of those different, outputs that are in those boxes there. So we have an evidence synthesis node, actually, and there we're talking about methods of evidence synthesis and what influences evidence synthesis. And we take a very broad look at this. So just in a nutshell, by what I mean is it's not just meta-analysis, which is quantitatively pulling studies together, like you see there on the right side, that meta-analysis, but it's also systematic reviews or other types of evidence synthesis that might be across different types of data sets, for example. We've been working with some government guideline developers who want to synthesize both animal and human and mechanistic data, for example. So this node is all about those methods, but it's also really about what introduces biases in the evidence synthesis, and again, conflicts of interest and funding source are an area that we're really interested in. And we've had a lot of success in this area in terms of actually influencing policy. So this is an example from the US. And what this illustrates here, that green box is a National Academy of Science report, and that report came out in 2014, and it actually said that the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency should use systematic review methods to do a risk assessment. So to evaluate whether a chemical was harmful to humans and should be classified as a hazard. And the way the EPA did that before actually didn't involve any sort of evidence synthesis. They would, which really floored me actually, they would pick what they thought was the best study and they would use that on, to base their risk assessment. So this report was really groundbreaking because it proposed what's in that red box there, which is to basically do systematic reviews. So to identify all the relevant evidence, to evaluate it, and to summarize it, and then to integrate it across these evidence streams. And 3 years later in 2017, I'm really kind of happy to say that US Congress, this is all documented in a recent congressional report, now mandates that the EPA has to use these methods. Now, there can be a downside of that in terms of policy because it might slow up some of these risk assessments, so we can talk about that. But in general, this is like a real upscaling of the methods that they're requiring EPA to use. And so in this area, we're working a lot here with guideline developers, and Jeff's working on some of this with WHO, and we have one of those new Sydney Policy Lab projects where we're working with NHMRC and WHO and the U.S. National Toxicology Program to develop some methods that they'll use in developing public health and, well, basically public health guidelines is what they're concerned about, environmental guidelines. So that's a very exciting project. We're going to have a meeting in April with a lot of guideline developers to present that work. So if anyone's interested, that you could come along to that. And then the last node we have really focuses on pharmaceutical policy, and this is, maybe it's because we've studied conflicts of interest, maybe it's because I'm a pharmacologist by training. Barbara was actually in a pharmacology department, does pharmacoepidemiology, so a lot of Alice has a big interest in pharma policy. So we have a lot of interest in drugs specifically. So we have this node now, which is basically to conduct research on what influences pharmaceutical policy. And one of the big cores of that is these databases that you all may have heard about. They've been written about a lot in the paper, where Medicines Australia releases data on payments to healthcare professionals, plus payments for educational events, and payments to consumer groups. And we've actually, it's open access data, but it's actually really, really hard to use. It comes out like all these individual PDF pages. So we've actually taken this data and created open access, usable databases that are linked to our site and made available for people to use and do research. And we've been doing some research on that, which you'll hear about a little more from Barbara. Oh, sorry, those are the databases. And what we're really interested here in moving the research is not just describing the amount of the payments. I mean, that can be pretty jaw-dropping and it's by itself, but it's just really trying to link the impact of those payments with health policy decisions, or for example, the statements of consumer groups on particular issues. So that's where we're headed on that. So that's a big, broad overview of what we're doing, and I'll turn it over to Quinn. You're next, right? Or Nick? Nick, sorry.
Do you want to sit here, Nick?
What is it? Yes.
Yeah.
Any questions at that point?
That's awesome. And so I had just a quick question about the meta-analysis concept. I understand that the Cochrane reviews are updated as more studies are added. But do you ever break studies down into time periods to look at whether that diamond can be shifting right or left over time? Or do you track whether bias might be increasing or decreasing?
That is a great idea. And it's called cumulative meta-analysis, and you can add studies in by time, and you can actually see the diamond if it's moving. And you can also see, I mean, what happens with most clinical questions is the diamond stops moving right or left, and the error just gets smaller and smaller and smaller. And so at some point you probably could have said, we didn't need to do any more studies on that because we know the answer. But that would be a very valuable method for actually tracking whether bias is going in different directions. And with Cochrane, you can actually go to that review and sort the studies by time. For that particular review, it doesn't make any difference. But it would be good to know.
May I ask you about the key sentence, asking an answerable, relevant question? I mean, that's common to all of the human sciences. It's common to all research. And I think it's the trickiest bit. And I'm wondering, without being tautological, how do you decide that? Is that probing? Is it poking, in the dark? Is it
wild
conjecturing? How do you, because everything follows from that.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I mean, most systematic reviewers, if they're really trying to do it right, they consult with stakeholders. So the people who might actually be using the results of their review, and they try to get an idea of what questions they want answered. And usually those questions are far too broad to be able to do a systematic review. And so then the work is breaking down those really broad questions into ones that can be answered by different systematic reviews. So a classic example in risk assessment is, you know, people want to know, should fire retardants, you know, still be allowed to go into pajamas? You know, that's the answer they want. So to do that, we have to know a lot about the effects of the fire retardants, you know, the length of exposure to the fire retardants, how fire retardants are actually absorbed if they're in pajamas. So that's, you know, a number of individual questions will need to be answered to get to that question about whether we need to do anything about fire retardants. Does that help?
Yeah, my misfortune is that I'm in the field of politics, and that's the central question all the time about the politics of who the stakeholders are, what frames of inquiry are chosen, never mind the methods and all of the complexities.
Well, I think we'll be getting to some of those things.
We will.
Well, and I did give you an easy answer to that question. I mean, even for systematic reviewers, I don't want you to think that's always easy.
Yeah,
it's a great question.
Good
morning. Fortunately for me, I've just had a daughter 2 weeks ago, so this feels quite familiar, holding it and people like this. So we now know the dietary guidelines are formulated to offer recommendations to reduce the incidence of diseases such as obesity, cardiovascular disease, and also diabetes. However, when these dietary guidelines have been based on systematic review methods, they've still been criticised for being biased and also offering conflicting recommendations. As Lisa mentioned before, in industry sponsorship, or in the research of around industry sponsorship of research, it's now apparent that the presence of an industry sponsor, you're more likely to find a favourable outcome towards the study sponsor. So last year we conducted a review looking at industry sponsorship and its association with nutrition research studies and the outcomes of nutrition studies. We did a review of reviews and we found 12 reviews. And within that analysis, we were looking at outcomes which included the results, the conclusions, and also we looked at the methodological quality. And we're looking at the difference between industry-sponsored and non-industry-sponsored studies. Down the bottom, you can see that it says there was a risk ratio of 1.31. So what that means is there was a likelihood of about 30% greater likelihood that industry-sponsored studies were more likely to have favourable conclusions than non-industry-sponsored studies. Unfortunately, the sample size of studies didn't allow us to do a quantitative assessment of the results or look at the methodological quality. So the issue being from a public health perspective, conclusions don't go into systematic reviews that make up dietary guidelines, it's the results. So we don't use conclusions, we need to use the quantitative data to actually make dietary guidelines. So there's a gap. So as a group, we're looking to fill that gap and we're looking to identify and assess whether the dietary guidelines or the evidence that goes into the dietary guidelines in Australia, whether they are biased by the presence of industry sponsorship or authors that have a conflict of interest. So that's exactly what we're doing at the moment with the current review and meta-analyses. We're looking to identify whether these studies, you know, within the dietary guidelines have more favourable results and or conclusions if they're sponsored by an industry or if there is a presence of industry sponsorship. And we also want to assess if there's a difference in their methodological quality, which we're going to get to in a second. I'll explain what that means. So in our current study, we included what we call observational studies. The study designs are called cohort and case controls. We had an extensive inclusion-exclusion criteria, but a couple of key ones that are here, if you don't understand what we're looking at. We wanted to quantitatively measure the effects of whole grain consumption in healthy humans. So our assessment in the dietary guidelines, we're looking at particular foods with particular outcomes. So for this particular study, we wanted to look at whole grain consumption, and our outcome measure was looking at cardiovascular outcomes. And I'll get to those outcomes in a moment. So we wanted to quantitatively measure the effect of whole grain consumption in healthy humans with cardiovascular outcomes. Our second outcome we looked at, our second inclusion criteria was that it had to have, as I said, an outcome measure related to cardiovascular disease. And the third inclusion criteria, which is really important, we're looking at the comparison between whole grain foods and a control, whole grain foods with other whole grain foods, or whole grain foods with other foods. So our primary outcomes, we're looking to assess, again, if industry-sponsored studies are more likely to have favourable results. We're looking at something called the effect size of the outcomes. So Lisa showed a meta-analysis before, and there was a little diamond at the bottom. We're going to look at the effect size across industry-sponsored and non-industry-sponsored studies. What we do is we pull those effect sizes together and then we compare the difference. We're also going to look, like we did in the first systematic review, we're going to look at whether there know, are more likely to have favourable conclusions in industry-sponsored studies. Our secondary outcome is the methodological quality of the studies and also concordance. So concordance hasn't been touched on yet today, but often there's a difference between the study results and then what the authors write up. So we used the 2009 process manual for the Australian Dietary Guidelines. We wanted to capture a sample that was very similar to the Australian Dietary Guidelines, if not exactly the same. So we used the review manual to create a search strategy. We used the same databases, so we tried to mirror as much as we could. These are just some of the databases that we searched. For methodological quality, we assessed it using something called the Robbins E tool, which is the risk of bias in non-randomized studies. So an observational study, which is what I mentioned our study was on, is what we call a non-randomized study. These are seven domains, so seven things that can be potentially influenced throughout the study design. So understand what a bias is, if you're not entirely sure in this context. It's the possibility that the feature of the study's design, its conduct, and also the analysis of the study can lead to a systematic error in the study's results or its inferences. So in other words, if you influence these seven domains, there is potential for leading to a biased effect size or outcome. This is our study flow diagram. We had an enormous sample size. We ran this search strategy for looking at observational studies, but we also put randomized control trials in there because we're going to do a separate study looking at randomized control trials. So we ended up with obviously a huge sample size. This is the process. We had two reviewers that went through basically looking at the inclusion criteria, looked at titles and abstracts, and then also the full text. And down the bottom, very small print, I do apologise, but it's the only way I could fit this on. We ended up with 22 studies in our sample. So where we're up to at the moment in terms of analysing the data, we're looking at the statistical significance of the results and conclusions, and you can see the top line there. We've combined industry sponsorship with authors that had a conflict of interest. We had a total of 10 of those studies. For non-industry sponsored studies, or those that didn't have an author with a conflict of interest with the food industry, we had a sample of 12. And we've run a risk ratio, we've run an assessment of the statistical significance and found that it's about 54% more likely that industry sponsored studies are likely to have a more favourable or statistically significant result. However, you can see that 95% confidence interval cross over 1, so from a statistical point of view, it's not statistically significant. For methodological quality, now this won't mean a great deal other than what I'm going to point to are the red and the green. Red means bad, green means good. These are the seven domains along the top here that we assessed for methodological quality. The tool that we're using isn't empirically based, and what I mean by that is it hasn't been shown that each domain, if it's influenced, actually leads to a biased effect size. The randomised controlled trial tool, which was designed by the Cochrane Collaboration, is empirically based. So the tool that we were using was hadn't been trialled in nutrition studies before, so we're actually trialling the tool, which was part of the outcome of the study. And one of the main flaws or errors, as you can see in this first domain, this first category, is that almost every study bar one is red. And that is for the domain of confounding. If you don't know what confounding is, it's a pre-intervention prognostic factor. And it can determine the outcome of interest, but also can determine whether a participant receives the exposure or not. So for that first domain, almost every single study ends up with a serious or critical risk of bias. The issue with this tool is that once a category has been categorised as serious or critical, no matter how well designed the rest of the study is, it can't move any lower. So you can see the overall risk of bias down the far right side. We almost end up with every study being serious or critical. So for methodological quality, we couldn't see any difference between industry and non-industry sponsored studies, potentially because of the way the tool's designed, but that's an important finding regardless. So in terms of what we need to do next, we need to do further assessment of industry sponsored studies in nutrition research. Due to the fact that our statistical or the confidence interval in our findings crossed over the 1, which meant it wasn't statistically significant. So we potentially, if we had a larger sample size, that may have made it statistically significant. But what we're going to do is we're going to continue to look at other foods with other outcomes. So at the moment, we're looking at whole grains and cardiovascular disease. We're looking to further that research or that analysis into dairy and also cardiovascular outcomes as well. So we're going to look at other foods. The second thing you can see is we want to design an empirically based tool to assess the risk of bias in observational studies. There is one for randomised controlled trials, but not for observational studies. And part of the work we're doing as a group is we're going to start to look at doing that. The next steps, what we're going to do to finish this study, is we're going to conduct a meta-analysis that Lisa mentioned previously in the work that she's done in the pharmaceutical industry. And we're going to compare the pooled effect in industry-sponsored studies with the pooled effect in non-industry-sponsored studies. And then we're going to do something called a meta-regression, where we're basically going to look at other explanatory variables that may have influenced that effect size, so things like the size of the sample in each study, the age of the population, etc. Thank you very much.
Should we take a few?
If you want, yeah, because we're all our talks are quite different. And one thing I'd like to throw out there, thanks, Nick, is the way we think about this is we try to differentiate these bias in the conclusions from bias in the results, and I think that's really important from the standpoint of the Truth Initiative, because the bias in conclusions is really about how the results are interpreted, and we know that's very important, in terms of policy. But if you're somebody like us, it's just not, you really want to know how the actual numbers are being biased. So I don't know if anybody here has a take on that, but to me that's an important distinction, and a lot of times we have trouble getting that across to people.
So it's the case that in scientific publishing, people, the general stance would be not to question the results, but to quarrel with conclusions or to sort of worry about conclusions, right?
Yeah, well, I think a lot of people just look at the conclusions of a study, frankly, if they're going to use it for a decision, and they don't actually look at the data. And so if the conclusion is much more favorable than the data, that's what they're going to see. Mm-hmm. And I think that a lot of studies are published, and we just had a review on spin in scientific literature. A lot of studies are published where the conclusion looks more favorable than the actual results tell you.
Yeah, I guess I was thinking more of other scientists reading it rather than, say, industry people reading it.
Right.
Where, I don't know your field, but more in sort of psychology, you've got people, potentially worrying about things like confounds and that sort of thing, but, saying, okay, taking the results more on face value, but saying, hang on, that actually is evidence against your, stance, or, I'm going to interpret that as evidence, towards, in favor of my competing theory or whatever.
Right, yeah.
I think it's also compounded by the publishing industry, because a big audience for a lot of biomedical research are practicing clinicians who may not have access to full texts. So there's a big issue also with published abstracts and the conclusions presented in there, and that's sometimes the only thing that a clinician would have access to.
Because the other stuff's behind paywalls?
Yeah.
I know from trying to publicise this stuff in the, to a broader public, sometimes when you're reading these papers, from our perspective, rarely will you quote the results section, because it's just numbers and no one knows what a confidence interval is. But if there's particularly in the abstract, but certainly in the conclusion, if there's an emphatic statement that says this has this effect, you'll take that statement and put it in your piece, because you generally trust that that's a fair representation of what's in the results. And most people whose jobs this isn't, they don't either have the time or the the background in this to really decide whether that what they put in the conclusion is actually a fair representation. You just have to kind of trust what the researcher or the,
And I guess that's actually really the function of peer review process should be, part of the peer review process should be analysing the data, but also determining whether or not the conclusions are in line with the data that's presented.
Okay, I'm sure we'll get back to some of these issues, but you might as well get some.
So I'm Quinn, I'm a postdoc, and I'm going to talk about some of my projects that really fall under the bias and research integrity node that Lisa mentioned. And that's part of why we had to become EPIC, because at the Charles Perkins Center, which is filled with wet lab researchers, we started to be known as the biased dry researchers. So we needed a new name.
Yes, the dry researchers, we didn't like that.
So I'm going to talk about some of, I would say, maybe the debates or trends within the world of studying conflicts of interest. And so I'd be interested to hear from other fields, whether this resonates at all, because I'm going to focus mostly on conflicts of interest in biomedicine. So here's an example of one of our leading journals. And when I talk about conflicts of interest, I'm going to use kind of a broad definition that was first proposed by the Institute of Medicine. And so this understands conflicts of interest to be a set of circumstances that creates a risk that a professional judgment or actions regarding a primary interest would be unduly influenced by a secondary interest. And for me, conflicts of interest are actually a very specific ethical phenomenon. So this is a problem for professionals, people who are in a position where others are relying on their expert judgment. And between those two interests, one of them has to have an ethical claim to priority. So in the case of professionals, this is often the best interest of the person who's relying on your judgment or some appeal to a public good. And this obviously did not originate in health or medicine. It actually was very much originally a business concept. It's probably well known in legal professions, politics, and other professional situations. But in biomedicine, we're seeing a trend where more and more commonly it's required that someone disclose their conflicts of interest. So we're seeing that very much in biomedical publishing. There'll be a section in an article where conflicts are disclosed. You'll see it often at conference presentations where the first slide will be peppered with someone's financial relationships with various commercial entities. People kind of glaze over it and shrug, or it's even a badge of honor at times. And probably less commonly, but in some medical schools, it's starting to become a more common practice that a lecturer, for example, would have a disclosure slide. So here's an example of a typical disclosure statement, and this is for this clinical trial published in a leading medical journal. And the fact that you can't read it is on purpose, because this is pretty much how it would appear in the published article. And if you read through it, so you can see, you know, Dr. Kimball reports receiving grant supports, consulting fees from AbbVie, Amgen, Dermira, Janssen, Novartis. And it goes on. It's a large research team, but I reckon that pretty well every pharmaceutical company that's currently active in Australia is listed somewhere in there. And I think the question for me remains that although these conflicts of interest are perhaps visible, what does this mean? And what does it mean for how the research was conducted, the impact of that research? If you're a clinician or a member of the public or a journalist trying to cover this trial, what do you do with this? It's a bit difficult to summarize, and it's challenging to understand what this means. If you keep reading past this in the published paper, there's actually finer print that acknowledges that AbbVie, a pharmaceutical company, funded this trial, and that they relied on AbbVie employees to do the statistical analysis, to write the first draft, and for other contributions. So in addition to these financial ties for individual authors, the study had a high degree of pharmaceutical company involvement. How that interacts, we really can't say. And I think what the effect of this has been in biomedicine is the sense that conflicts of interest are ubiquitous. So you look at that, you see these leading clinical trialists, many of them highly respected in their fields. This begins to appear that having financial ties to commercial entities with a stake in the research is common practice. And the way it's being talked about by thought leaders in the field, an example would be the editor of the New England Journal of Medicine, is that these conflicts are actually unavoidable, if not desirable. So we actually conducted a study recently. Despite the fact that every publication now has that statement, there's actually no data as to how prevalent conflicts of interest are in biomedicine, and partly that's because these disclosures are really difficult to access. You have to dig through individual PDFs. It's hard to trace them. It's still a voluntary thing, so there's a high rate of non-disclosure. It's really hard. Maybe as a linguist, you'd be interested. We found, I think, over 120 ways that authors could state they had no conflicts of interest, the longest statement requiring 63 words, I think. So there's not a lot of standardization to this practice. But in the end, after it took us a while to arrive at this number, we found that just under 1 in 4 biomedical research articles have at least one author with a conflict of interest. So although that is still a significant minority, it is in fact a minority, and I think that the discourse that conflicts of interest are everywhere and unavoidable needs to be challenged. And you'll see for things like expert guideline committees or other instances where we're looking for expert decision makers, people are justifying the use of experts with significant financial conflicts by saying, well, it's impossible to find someone without a conflict. And I think what we are starting to theorize around is whether conflicts of interest create what I call a megaphone effect. So we know that it's actually a minority of authors or research where conflicts of interest are present, yet somehow when authors are conflicted, their papers are getting more attention. So we found that papers where at least one author had a conflict of interest are published in higher impact journals. They're also receiving more media attention. So these articles had a higher median altmetric score, which is a measure of social and mainstream media attention. And I think theoretically we're starting to think through what the impact of sponsorship in terms of being able to influence a position. These financial relationships allow that influence to occur across multiple settings. So it could be an author on that clinical trial, it could be a different expert sitting on a guideline committee, it could be someone writing a high impact editorial, but that sponsor is able to influence different biomedical settings and the decisions that happen there through these financial relationships. So another development that has really caught my interest, and so I'm going to talk a little bit about non-financial interests and work that I haven't started yet, so I'm interested in your feedback on this. But what we're starting to see, in addition to those page-long tallies of financial conflicts, are disclosures like this. So here's a competing interest. I'm a National Health Service GP partner. My income's partly dependent on this framework. I've written 2 books. I've earned from broadcast and freelance journalism. I'm an unpaid patron of Health Watch. And then, you know, I've invested a small amount of money in a social enterprise. Who made your pants? So we basically have someone's biography accompanying their published work. This one, I think, is my favorite. This was a systematic review on male circumcision. So you get BFI, he's the author, is an adherent of Orthodox Judaism, not affiliated with the religious sects that commonly practice direct oral suction during circumcision, nor is he affiliated with any of the organizations represented in the legal case addressing the informed consent rule. He and his sons underwent ritual Jewish circumcision without direct oral suction. The other author is a non-practicing Roman Catholic whose wife affiliates with secular Judaism. He and his son were circumcised by pediatricians in the hospital setting. So reading that, I think, TMI, too much information. But it is now, I think, someone did a study, over half of the core clinical journals now require authors to disclose some form of non-financial competing interest. So this includes personal beliefs, political affiliations, organizational membership, and then vague things like anything that might be perceived to influence. One I think is really interesting is intellectual conflict of interest. So we had a colleague recently that he published a commentary in Nature. He had to disclose that he writes frequently about conflict of interest in a published commentary on conflict of interest, which seems like a poor use of space in my opinion, but it's a very interesting development. And I think more disturbingly, so you might be disturbed by the too much information, but what I am sensing is that the end destination, if we start treating these non-financial interests in the same way that we've treated financial conflicts of interest, and I'm certainly not advocating that that disclosure practice has solved that problem, but that we arrive at a place where the ideal is someone who doesn't know and doesn't care. So here's an example, the United States Preventative Services Task Force. So this is an independent group of experts that makes recommendations for screening tests, other public health programs. There's some heavyweight guidelines, and they have this conflict of interest policy, and this is on their published website. So Michael J. Berry is one of their current committee members. He has a level 3 disclosure. So Dr. Berry has done extensive work on prostate cancer, including receiving multiple grants and authoring publications. He's an academic. He has also expressed that he has strongly held beliefs related to prostate cancer. Not sure what that means. And I would hope he's interested in prostate cancer if he's dedicated his life's work to that. But the action, so they've identified this as an intellectual conflict of interest, and Dr. Berry will be recused from participating in any work group deliberating or voting on prostate cancer-related topics.
What's the rationale?
It's his intellectual conflict of interest.
So that he can't be balanced.
Right, they think he's biased. See, this all relates to the... Yeah, they just assume that you're biased because they assume that's a conflict of interest.
But the financial conflicts of interest don't cause you to be recused.
Not always. So
sometimes.
Financial conflict of interest is typically managed through disclosure, like we've seen, and then occasionally someone would be recused on the basis, or they'd have to divest themselves from those ties. But I think differently than the financial conflicts of interest, he obviously can't divest himself from his strongly held beliefs about prostate cancer. So labeling it as a conflict of interest and treating it as such leads to him being recused. So as we started this...
Do you think it's the last sentence, though? In that? I mean, that's the problem, right?
The strongly held beliefs?
Yeah. Presumably, right?
Yeah. And I think it's fascinating because...
It is an unclear... declaration. It doesn't say I'm well aware of the evidence and know what the current best practice is. It says.
Well, and what's fascinating is that disclosure is, it's a voluntary thing. So Michael Berry would have disclosed that, knowing that it would
presumably, without the last sentence, he wouldn't have been refused.
Yeah, not sure.
But I mean, it's a little more complicated because even without making that statement, there's numerous examples of Cochrane reviewers, so basically somebody who's published a Cochrane review that has a finding that got peer-reviewed and published, and they've been taken off of WHO guideline committees because they have too strong a view on the topic because they've published a Cochrane review. Which to me is like not a strong view. It just said, well, you did the review, and it got published, and it has a conclusion, but does that mean it's, you know... That you have
Do you remember the example of the woman recently who was recused from something on child health because she was a mother and a pediatrician and therefore she cared about children? I forget, it was some sort of expert committee. So,
And the other, a big issue with this at Quinn, this is one of my pet peeves, but is a lot of this that people are being accused of bias over things that are in the public record. Like if you're an academic, you know, your publication record is out there, but if it's not in the public record, then you run into risk of asking people things that might even be unethical to ask them, or you get the case with conflicts, financial conflicts of interest where they're just not disclosing. So it's a lot of it's information dependent.
And I find it interesting that his multiple grants, you don't know where they were from.
The funding is kind of...
Yeah, he may have funding from manufacturers of either of screening tests, of the PSA tests or other tests for prostate cancer. We just don't know from what he said.
Yeah.
I'm having trouble understanding what the counterfactual is here. Is it objectivity? Is it it some sort of angelic status? Because it seems to me, in this discussion, you have to be an angel, you know, who knows no time and space to actually measure up to the standards that are being applied.
Or a robot. And it's, I think, so what I'm hoping to draw from are the feminist science and technology scholars, the field of science and technology studies, because it seems to be news in biomedicine that research happens in social context.
Yeah.
And I think one of the big questions here is if Michael J. Barry is recused, who's still in the room and who is labeled as objective?
Well, and who recuses the recusers?
Yes, yeah. So I'm thinking about this as a politics of exclusion at the moment. There was a great piece written recently by Jean Lenzer, who writes for the BMJ. She analyzed a number of decisions for drug approval at the Food and Drug Administration in the United States. And she analyzed cases where an intellectual conflict of interest became relevant and a decision was made. And in every case, the individual was recused on the basis of a conflict of interest when they expressed really strong views about the safety of a drug. And in every one of those cases, then the decision was favorable to the industry whose drug was up for review. And nobody in any of those cases was recused for financial conflicts, even though we know that they're actually rife on those committees. So I think there's a potential here for industry interference. And again, we see this discourse that, well, financial conflicts of interest are so common, everybody's got them. These non-financial interests are really what's important. And this is what we're reading and hearing about, that there's something very significant for people making decisions when someone has a strong theoretical affinity or a political affiliation or has been working on the same hypothesis for decades. This issue seems to get mixed up with things like nepotism. There seems to be a lot at work. This crisis of reproducibility in science, I think, is also relevant. And it's kind of this shock that these results are being influenced by the settings and the people who actually do the research, and they don't seem to have the language or theoretical tools to sort that out. I do think it's related. I think there's also some really big issues here with personal religious beliefs or your gender and sexual orientation in terms of, so if you're, you know, if you're doing a clinical guideline on abortion, for example, does everyone at the table have to disclose whether they've had personal experience with that? Or as we saw with the Judaism and circumcision example, and then of course your political affiliations. And at what point is this now an ethical issue around privacy? And when does it become relevant? And actually, I think a lot of these positions are relevant to science, and we've seen patterns of exclusion across them, and this is maybe a new form.
Well, it does seem to be sort of social media at its extreme, and I would question the people who are attacking the academics or researchers, that what is their agenda? Because, you know, you can find out so much information about somebody and say, well, you must be biased because you hold these views where you wrote this article. But as long as it's good science, then it should be able to stand up for itself. Maybe that's a bit idealistic. But there's been a lot of bad science where people have had things like about the link between autism and the vaccination, and a lot of that is still being churned, and people are quoting it even though the original papers have now been discredited. It's very hard to sort of change people's beliefs. And to me, it's sort of social media partly driving this, that if somebody doesn't like what you're saying or the conclusions you've reached, they can find ways to attack you by, you know, looking at your background and saying, well, you know, you're a woman, of course you're going to have that view.
I think part of it comes from this distrust of experts. And so a lot of the groups that are really pushing this, like WHO is redoing their guidelines for guidelines to try to incorporate a lot more of this non-financial, so is NHMRC, we're fighting against it. And I think it comes from this years of, well, we should be evidence-based, and personally I agree with that, but that has somehow made experts just so bad, if you're an expert. And so if you demonstrate that you are an expert somehow, that you wind up with this, so it's an overreaction. But what's worrisome is a lot of these organizations that have a lot of power in the terms of, you know, public health policy, you know, this is really their view now, is to control these things. And
that's our sense, actually, that it's coming less from, it's not so much attacks from members of the public or people from the outside trying to discredit you. It's, I think biomedicine has shot itself in its own foot.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's a lot of this philosophy around evidence-based medicine, again, that things used to happen by expert consensus, and we've undermined that. It's almost like people that really believed in conflict of interest and managing financial conflicts of interest have now just kept running with that idea that if we could just manage all the bias, if we could just get all the biases out of the process, then we'd have some sort of pure, objective science. And I think it's a bit disturbing when we take that to its full conclusion. So these are some of our questions. I'd be glad to chat more about this, but kind of interested in understanding why, it's not that these interests aren't important or that they're not influential, but why are we calling it a conflict of interest? What's the impact when we label it that way? Like we said, who gets to be objective, given that we all have interests? And then how might these interests be meaningfully engaged, other than through recusal or these packing them into these disclosure forms?
Yeah.
I mean, I see a lot of that in terms of my own day-to-day work as a biomedical science. So what I'm seeing happening is that conflict of interests are being recognised. Of course, that's a good thing, but I'll just give an example. Recently, I was asked to examine a PhD thesis at this university, and I examine a lot of PhD theses, and then most of them I really know very little about, you know, but I'm still asked as an examiner because it's difficult to find people. So on this occasion, I was actually asked to examine a thesis that I was really sincerely interested in the results, and I was waiting for the thesis, and then I wrote to the supervisor and said, oh, what's happening? And he said to me, I know you've been ruled out. You have conflict of interest. And I just thought, God, the one occasion where I've actually got something to say, I'm not allowed to express my expertise. And I think that is something that's happening in terms of NHMRC reviewing in a small country such as Australia. You know, often the people that actually have the expertise to best critique the proposed experiments are those that are removed from the process.
Yes.
And so the people that remain are actually the people that are working in expertise. So
yeah.
That is a bit of stimulus.
I think it's really interesting. I guess maybe to play a little bit of the devil's advocate, because I mean, I know when I publish a paper and I have to fill out these non-financial interests, I think, well, I do have a big interest in this. I care about whether I get promoted.
Yeah.
I care about whether I get my next grant.
Yeah,
sure.
And those things, you know, have a strong influence on.
That's
could have a strong influence on how I write my conclusion relative to my results and all these types
true.
Of things. So it's a real. I think there are. You know, there's a good reason that people are thinking about these things, but yeah, as you say, if you take it to the sort of logical extreme, it's ridiculous because no one can comment on anything.
But that's one of my favorite examples. You want to get promoted. So does that mean we should only have people on committees who don't want to get promoted? You know, like the unambitious people who have like no, like who doesn't want to get promoted? Who doesn't want to do well in their career? So it's an interest, but it's not a conflict of interest.
It is a question, though, of whether wanting to get promoted changes the research that how I define a question, which you referred to earlier, how I go about answering it, you know, whether I don't publish one study that's inconsistent. So I think those are, you know, it is a genuine concern.
So that's actually the project that we're just about to start, and I'm a qualitative researcher, so I want to find people, researchers, but also journal editors who are developing these policies, these members of guideline committees, and I want people to share situations in which one of these interests, non-financial interests, was seen to be relevant. Because I think we're calling it, you know, ethical shorthand. I think labeling it a conflict of interest actually covers over what all might be going on in that situation. So we don't get to have the conversation about how do the incentive structures for research influence the questions that get asked and the work that gets done. We don't get to talk about other things like gender or religion or political affiliations. And I get the sense that these interests matter. Of course they matter. They matter to people. But what is actually going on in those situations, I think, needs a bit more unpacking.
Are you at the end
I'm
of your...
Done.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, because we've got one more speaker, so
yeah.
I feel like we should keep going, and then we can come back to the broader discussion when everyone's sure.
And I probably have
to
leave one, but right.
Okay. It's okay. I won't think that you're leaving.
No.
Yeah, Liz has given her apologies in advance that she'll sneak out. So.
The arrows, okay. Yeah. So I'm Barbara Mintzes. I'm going to be talking about pharmaceutical industry funding of health professionals, so what I've called undue influence here. So, and the research that we've been doing in our team on reports of that funding. And so I wanted to just start the this was not a, this wasn't really planned, but I was at a university where in a medical faculty it was standard to have a to disclose your financial conflicts of interest. So I don't have any non-financial ones there, but like everybody else, I have opinions and such, that I don't have pharmaceutical industry funding. I have been a paid expert witness in two legal cases on behalf of plaintiffs concerning harmful effects, class action suits on harmful effects of pharmaceuticals. And that is a little bit relevant to this. This presentation. So I wanted to start with, this is actually just from a press report, but I thought it was a nice overview of the main types of funding that pharmaceutical companies provide to health professionals, and the large majority of this funding is going to physicians and to, I guess, what you would call GPs and physicians here. And we've been talking a bit about grants for research and involvement in clinical trials. There are a number of other types of funding that are very widespread. Funding to be a member of an advisory board of a company, to receive speaking fees, to be part of a speaker's bureau for a company, and to be a consultant for a company. Those three together would be types of funding that within the pharmaceutical marketing literature are called key opinion leader funding. So often, so companies will involve particularly expert clinicians very centrally in their marketing activities. The other types of funding that are very widespread are to pay for expenses for physicians to attend events and to sponsor events that physicians and other health professionals attend. Now, there's been a shift globally in that there's been an introduction of what is called Sunshine legislation. Probably the best known internationally is the U.S. Sunshine Act, which was actually brought in as part of the Health Reform Act, or what's called Obamacare. And this is, so both legislation and self-regulatory initiatives that require pharmaceutical companies to report publicly on their financing of health professionals. Now, Australia was actually one of the first countries to bring in transparency reports under a self-regulatory framework, so under the Industry Association, Medicines Australia. Since 2007, all Australian companies have been required to report publicly on all sponsored events for health professionals. And that reporting has occurred until 2015. And so those sponsored events, that's actually unique globally in terms of the type of reporting. Most of the Sunshine Acts report in terms of funding to individuals. In this type of reporting, individuals were not named. Now that's shifted recently, which I'll talk about. I call that largely buried in plain sight, and Lisa referred to that in her presentation, that this has come in a whole range of different PDFs every 6 months from different companies. So essentially there were two medical literature publications right after the first 6 months, a lot of painstaking transcribing of these reports into a large database, and then nothing for almost 10 years. And our group put these reports together into a large analyzable database. Alicia Fabri, who's here, is the lead author on the first detailed report on this funding. And what we found, in a nutshell, is that these events are very frequent, ubiquitous. So in Australia, a rather small country in terms of population, that over this four-year period, there are nearly 117,000 events, an average of over 600 weekly, that food and drink were provided at over 90% of events, and that also the industry's reported spending of $286 million Australian dollars on the sponsorship of these events. Specialist physicians were the most common attendees, at around two-thirds of events, And in 80%, there were physicians of some kind attending, though actually nurses attended quite a few events as well. I think it was about 40%, and trainees, so medical interns and residents, also at about 40% of events. Now, they're called educational events. If you look at the Medicines Australia website and how these events are reported, sort of the framing of the report. So this is a very typical, it's actually an invitation for one of the events. I should also say about 60% of them were in clinical settings in hospitals or doctor's offices, but quite a few were also at restaurants, evening events. So this is a typical where you have a clinical expert, Dr. Katz in this case, who's presenting about the anxious, depressed patient. It's at a nice restaurant in Melbourne. And then you have on the event invitation, you have this image. This was a AstraZeneca-sponsored event. In the previous year, they had been running numerous ads for their antipsychotic drug that was also approved as a secondary treatment for treatment-resistant depression and for generalized anxiety disorder, that's quetiapine or Seroquel. So I can just remind you, look at this image. Essentially, they're using the same advertising image. And in terms of the content of that event as well, these are being sponsored for a reason, which is also promoting specific medications. In the database, we could see there were certain events where there were drug names mentioned, like the launch of Prolia, et cetera. The large majority do not mention a drug name. So as I mentioned, about 90% of them involve meals of some kind, food, and sometimes you have detailed description of sushi and various things. What do we know about whether that influences prescribing or not? There's actually been the best research on this has come out of the data provided in the Physician Sunshine Act, because you have funding for many thousands of physicians in that database, which then can be combined with prescribing data for Medicare and Medicaid. And a group, De Jong is the lead author, this was in JAMA Internal Medicine last year. They looked in four treatment areas at the likelihood of prescribing the drug that belonged to the manufacturer that sponsored the event as a proportion of prescribing it for a specific for a specific treatment area. And you'll see that they have a dose response in terms of numbers of sponsored meals. And these were mainly very cheap meals, so it's partly things like sandwiches, essentially, or lunches that were being provided. I think the average cost was less than $20 US. So essentially, because we now have the large databases available from these Sunshine Acts, we actually know much more about, we have a better sort of research evidence in terms of what is the influence of this pharmaceutical industry largesse on physician prescribing. Now, in Australia, we've seen a shift in the reporting requirements, and that's both good and bad. So what I would call the bad part is that the data on provision of food has disappeared. So the companies are no longer required to report that. And as I mentioned, that was at over 90% of events. Also, around two-thirds of them, the funding that was provided was only for food and drinks. So that will just disappear from sight. The positive side in terms of the changes is that there is now reporting that actually names all of the individuals who are receiving funding. So it's shifted to a reporting system that is much more similar to what has occurred in other jurisdictions. And there is the potential that knowing that the financing if people know that the financing they receive from companies is publicly reported, that could affect the decision whether to accept that financing or not. So we just have the first year of full reporting starting in May 2016. The total was $23.6 million, and that's kind of interesting because the average per year was over $70 million with the event reporting. So that event reporting has disappeared. So that just means that there's a funding that for room rentals, for a lot of other things, and also for the food that is now out of the picture. The most common type of funding was for travel and accommodation, followed by consulting services. And when it comes to food, that's out of the picture.
Could I just ask, what was the rationale for removing the food reporting? Was it the fact that people just need food?
No, well, people, they don't necessarily need a free lunch, right?
No,
they need food. So the rationale is that, so this is an industry self-regulatory process, and what Medicines Australia brought in is a limit so that companies are not allowed to spend more than $120 per person on food and drink at a meal, which is actually way more than the average previously in the database. And you can get quite a nice, I think you can get quite a nice meal for that. And so the rationale was they brought in these restrictions on spending, and therefore there's no need to report. I think that that's a mistaken rationale. Mm-hmm. The ACCC actually also has an oversight role in terms of approving Medicines Australia's code. And I mean, that's one of the things that we are talking about doing is meeting with them and discussing our findings in relation to whether this makes sense or not. If there's public disclosure, that it should also include meals. Now, I think the other, sorry?
Yeah, I was just going to make a point that, $120 seems very high, and shouldn't it actually be more based, like, on the gift register, say, for politicians, if it's something over, you know, some figure like $30, $25,
mm-hmm.
irrespective of the nature that the industry reports it. So that would be a fairer way rather than, you know, say spending $10 on sandwiches. Well, nobody cares or needs to know about that. But if you take them out to a nice restaurant and they spend $119, well, you're saying that doesn't need to be reported?
Yeah. Well, it's kind of interesting because actually that data from the U.S. Physician Sunshine Act was also on those sorts of sandwiches and such. And we know from the social science and psychology literature that even small gifts can have an influence on people's feelings of warmth towards the gift giver, and also feelings of reciprocity. And a lot of that is just human and unconscious as well. And I think, you know, so there is an argument to be made to say that that really having a threshold for what would be considered an acceptable gift isn't necessarily the way to go, rather than, so I should speed up a little. Okay, I will. I'm just about coming to the end. So one of the sides that sort of underlies this is there's a widespread belief among physicians that they're not influenced by exactly those small gifts or even larger amounts of largesse, that they can, you know, that their prescribing decisions and their practice is independent of this funding from industry. And this comes from qualitative research, this comes also from survey research, and if you ask the same question about, like, do you think you're influenced, generally people say no. Do you think your colleague is influenced? That's a bit of a different story. So it's partly saying we're all humans. I like this image especially from Le Monde in terms of the whole situation, because it's also this side of how much does this lead physicians to see the world through pill-colored glasses. And I think that there's, when you look back at the ubiquitous nature of these events as well, how common they are in everyday practice, that there's a side where perhaps the first solution for many common health problems will be a pharmaceutical, where there might be a non-drug option or a wait-and-see type option available as well. And also that some of the thresholds from for diagnoses and the way conditions are framed can also be very affected by commercial influences as well. Now, that's physicians, just one slide on patients and consumers. Since 2013, the Medicines Australia Code has also required companies to report on funding to consumer groups, and we're just starting on the analysis of that. And there's a tendency to see consumers as wanting to get faster access to new drugs, wanting to have fuller payment no matter what. And part of that, I think, needs to be seen in terms of how frequently are the organizations that are representing consumers and patients funded by the companies that market those drugs. So I will just conclude by saying that there actually are many solutions to undue influence from pharmaceutical industry funding of health professionals, and these can be individual solutions, institutional solutions, such as restrictions that a hospital or a medical faculty might have, or regulatory solutions as well. And this is just an image of an Australian initiative. It's within, globally, there's this no free lunch type groups. In Australia, it's no advertising, please. So it's an initiative where mainly primary care doctors have taken a stand to say that they will not accept pharmaceutical industry funding. Anyway, thank you.
So we have time for discussion and specifically starting on Barbara's presentation, but also broadening out to the rest. Thank you, Lisa. We'll see you soon.
I'd love to talk to anybody if we have to.
So normally we finish at 5:30, but we actually have the room until 12, so we don't have to rush out. But if people need to leave at that time, that's fine. But I feel like there's plenty to discuss. There is free coffee and free fruit and brand labels on there. Ralph's, advertising it. So let's open up the discussion. Maybe I just want to say, sit down. Just kind of raise a question about. It seems to be kind of naive of the people. You gave their view about whether they were being influenced or not, and it sort of seems pretty naive of them to say, oh, I'm not influenced, you know. So I'm just wondering to the extent to which, and I was looking at this, and I was thinking to myself, you're talking about specialists, the well-off people, presumably, and, you know, but busy, so, you know, if there's a free lunch, they're sort of gobbled up, but you don't want to sort of, one wonders what motivates them. It's not like a roll of ham and a roll of cheese kind of thing. But maybe it's a networking thing. Maybe, you know, who knows what reasons there are for them turning up. But if I was a drug company person, you know, I'd be just thinking about the psychology of it. And I'd be thinking about things like, you know, the availability heuristic where, you know, this person is stressed. They have to produce a prescription they've got to come to a conclusion. What am I going to give this person? Oh, I know. You know, the last lunch I was at was saying this is a great thing for depressed people. It's the new thing.
Right.
Saying this, but I'm just sort of wondering. I mean, that's like seems like a pretty simple explanation, which would be a very good sort of tool. Is you just exploit people's cognitive biases essentially. And say, well, whatever's in the front of my mind, I'm going to be much more likely to prescribe that. And you showed it with those charts, with the lunches and stuff like that.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think, also I realize I use the word physician in a North American way to mean all doctors. So it's, but it was specialists more often than GPs, but definitely GPs as well. But I think what's interesting, so I've been involved in a study that was focus groups of GPs about their interactions with pharmaceutical sales representatives, and one of the things that they said they appreciated was being reminded about new drugs. So it's exactly that side. I think the food is just, it can be just a way to get the person there, that it's convenience. It's not necessarily that the person, you know, certainly doctors can afford to buy their own
But sometimes, it's on the psychology, it is about the sort of special attention that you've got to individually invite.